Okay, so we were studying the exciting topic of root locus plot. And the idea is to plot roots of 1 plus k gs, which is the same as r locus g of s. So this is the r locus is the command in MATLAB for plotting the root locus. And there were 7 ingredients of root locus. The first one was root locus on real line. Second one was sigma a. Third one was phi a. Fourth one was root locus intersection with imaginary axis. So this is all a preview, a review of what we did in the previous class. The fifth one was breakaway point. So this was d over ds minus 1 over gs equal to 0. And then the sixth one was angle of departure. And seventh one was angle of arrival. Okay, so among all these 7 things, we have done number 1. So the root locus on real line is are the line segments that are on the left of odd number of poles and zeros. Sigma a, there was a formula given in the previous class, so that's the centroid. So summation of zeros minus summation of poles over n minus m. Phi a is the angle of the asymptotes. Root locus intersection with imaginary axis, we haven't done that yet, but we'll use root array to do this particular, to figure out where it's going to intersect with the imaginary axis. Breakaway point, we haven't done it yet, but we just need to solve a polynomial of this type in order to find the breakaway point, so we'll do this today. So we're going to do 4 and 5 today. Angle of departure, we have seen several examples of that. Angle of arrival, we have seen several examples of that in the previous lecture. So today, the goal is to find out the intersection of root locus with imaginary axis first, and then we'll talk about breakaway point. So let me start with g of s equal to 1 over s plus 2. S plus 4, okay? So 1 plus k gs is s cube plus 6 s square plus 8 s plus k over okay, so the goal is, so we need to find the intersection of root locus with imaginary axis. So that goal we understand, but it now has to be translated into something mathematical. So I'm going to translate this goal into something that's mathematical. So find k such that s cube plus 6s square plus 8s plus k, so that's the numerator polynomial because we are interested in roots of 1 plus k gs. So the numerator has s square plus some real number, I don't want to use r, S square plus A. Have we used A? No. Okay. S square plus A multiplied by some other transfer function, G tilde of S. Or let me write it as polynomial, so Q of S. Okay, so if I can find a value of k such that this can be factorized into a polynomial s square plus a, so this implies that the roots are going to be on the imaginary axis, and then some other function that I don't really care about, then we'll be good. Then we'll be able to figure out where root locus intersects at the imaginary axis. So the answer for that would be plus minus square root of a, plus minus j square root of a, if we can solve for this. Before I jump on to that, let me draw the pole zero diagram. So minus 4, minus 2, 0. There are no zeros for this problem. And if I go to my root locus plot, so this is number 3, and the root locus would look like okay, this is what the root locus is going to look like. And we are interested in finding this point. Okay, so let's construct the root array. Okay, so this is the root array for this polynomial. Now let's look at the goal. I need to find a value of k such that this factorizes into a polynomial of s square plus a type and some other polynomial. When do we have a factor of this type? Anyone remembers from root arrays discussion? When do we have product of two polynomials? So remember we had talked about auxiliary polynomial, right? So when you have an auxiliary polynomial, you can split a polynomial into product of two polynomials, right? We had done that for several examples in the class. So we need to look for an auxiliary polynomial in this table. And anyone remembers when we used to construct an auxiliary polynomial? Under what conditions?
When a whole row is 0,
then we construct an auxiliary polynomial. So this row can never be 0. This row can never be 0. This row can be made 0 if we pick k equals to 48. Okay? So let's pick k equals to 48. And then what's the auxiliary polynomial we have? Let me write it as Q1 of S. This is my auxiliary polynomial, and that's constructed from the row right above the 0 row. So that's 6S square plus K, which is equal to 48. So 6S square plus 8. Question, yeah.
Couldn't you also just set k equals 0 and still rub it all that?
Oh, so when k is equal to 0, this is 48 over 6. Oh, all right. So what happens if k is equal to 0? So this will be 0. So you will construct an auxiliary polynomial from this side, which would just be s. So not of the form s squared plus a. Okay. So we need a form s squared plus a. Yeah.
Why are we looking for the form of s squared plus a?
Oh, because we want to know where is the root locus going to intersect with the imaginary axis, right? So these are the points that we are interested in.
Yeah.
So at k equals to 48, this polynomial will get factorized into a term which is s squared plus a multiplied by some other polynomial. Okay, so this would be my plus j square root of a, this will be my minus j square root of a. That will be the closed loop pole for.
Do we want that because of the shape? We want that shape, is that what
we're. So we know that the shape of the root locus is going to look like this. We know that it will have an asymptote that looks like this. Well, this should look. It should look as if it's converging to the asymptote. But we don't quite know where exactly it's going to intersect, right? It's also important to note that for any value of k less than 48, this term is going to be negative. This term is going to be negative. So this term is going to be positive, and this is positive. So you don't have any sign changes. So the closed loop system is going to be stable. Okay? So k equals to 48 is the critical gain after which the system will become unstable, before which the system will be stable. So there are many reasons why you would want to know when is the system going to become unstable, and you want to make sure that your gain is smaller than that. And at the same time, this approach will allow you to figure out where exactly is the root locus going to intersect with the imaginary axis. So you have dual, you can solve multiple problems with just this approach. Okay? It just helps in drawing the root locus. Okay? Any other question? Okay, so let's go over the approach once again. I want to figure out where is the root locus going to intersect with the imaginary axis. This statement is equivalent to finding a value of k such that the polynomial 1 plus kgs, so the polynomial can be factorized into an expression s squared plus a multiplied by some other polynomial. And so we constructed the Ruth array. We figured out under what conditions one of the rows can be set to be equal to 0. We constructed the auxiliary polynomial in this fashion. And we saw that at k equals to 48, this expression can be factorized into something which is s squared plus 8 multiplied by some other polynomial. This s squared plus 8 implies that at k equals to 48, the closed loop pole would be at plus minus j square root of 8. Okay, and that would be the intersection point of this root locus with the imaginary axis. Any question at this time? What happens to the third pole? So it will have three poles, right? So I figured out the two poles. What about the third pole? Where is the third pole going to be? Any thoughts? Okay. Let me repeat the question again. This is a third order polynomial. At k equals to 48, I've figured out two poles that are going to be at the imaginary axis. What about the third pole? Where is that going to be? So this is the root locus. Let me remove the asymptotes because that's not part of root locus. So We know the root locus looks like this, and it looks like this, and it looks like this. So as I increase the value of k, these two poles are going to move closer and closer, and then it will break away, and then it will move in this direction. Whereas this pole is going to move in that direction as I increase the value of k. So at k equals to 48, I'll have two poles at plus minus j square root of 8. And I'll have the third pole somewhere here. Okay, Okay, so the third pole is going to be somewhere here, far away from minus 4. But the system would still be unstable because, not unstable, but marginally stable because you have two poles at the imaginary axis and one pole which is far away from the imaginary axis. Any question? Okay. All right, so number 4 is done. Now we need to look at the breakaway point. And let's continue with this example. So the breakaway point is this point. The point at which the root locus leaves the real axis and moves into the imaginary plane. This is my breakaway point. And the way to compute breakaway point is to set the derivative to be equal to 0. So my g of s is given d over ds minus s, s plus 2, s plus 4. S square 12s plus 8 equal to 0. Okay, so g of s is 1 over blah, blah, blah. So I have to take minus 1 over gs and then differentiate with respect to s. So this is minus 1 over gs differentiating with respect to s. I get this expression. When is this equal to 0? Let's do it. Minus 12 plus minus square root of 144. Minus 96 over 6. Can someone calculate this number and tell me what these two values are?
Minus 2 plus or minus 2 over 3.
No, just the numerical value. Yeah. What would the numerical value be? Minus 3.15 and minus?
No, the root
1.84?
Yeah.
Is this what the roots are?
It's just
0.84. Oh, 0.84, okay. Okay, so I got two answers for this expression. One is minus 3.15 and minus 0.84. Thankfully, we have all zero roots, so I mean real roots, so that's great. Let's look at the root locus. Where is minus 3.15? Somewhere here. Okay, and that does not belong to the root locus. So therefore, I'm going to ignore this solution. Not on root locus. Minus 0.84, that's on the root locus. So this is where the root locus is going to break away from the real line, and this is minus 0.84. That's the breakaway point here for this particular root locus. Okay. Okay. So that completes the root locus for, completes all the discussion for root locus. So now you should be able to, so given any transfer function g of s, you can just follow this approach. So find the root locus on real line, compute the asymptotes, compute where root locus is going to intersect with the imaginary axis, compute the breakaway point, angle of departure, angle of arrival. Once you compute all of this, then you just have to draw a graph which meets all these points. And that's it. The root locus construction will be complete. So now we are going to apply this approach to a different transfer function and compute everything by hand, okay? That's the goal. So the g of s, oh, I need to erase this side as well. S plus 1 over S plus 2, S plus 3. Okay. Let's draw the pole zero diagram. I have a 0 at negative 1. I have a pole at 0. Minus 2. Minus 3. Yes.
That last one that you had up there, we never found that third pole, did we?
We didn't find out?
We were talking about a third pole, like beyond the negative 4.
Yes.
We never found that, did we?
No, we don't need to find that out.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right now, the goal is to come figure out what the shape of the root locus is going to look like. Okay. All right. So this is the pole zero diagram. Let's draw the root locus on real line. So that's going to be this. So I go from my plus infinity towards minus infinity on the real axis. I encounter the first pole. I draw the root locus all the way up to the first pole or zero I encounter. So in this case, it's going to be a zero. Then I stop drawing the root locus. Then I reach the third pole or zero. So this is 1, 2, 3. So this is the third pole. I'm going to draw all the way up to the fourth pole or zero that I reach on the real axis. So that's the root locus on the real axis. What about, so n is 3, that's the degree of the denominator. M is 1, that's the degree of the numerator. So n minus m is equal to 2. Sigma A will be sum of zeros minus sum of poles over n minus m. Is it poles minus zeros or zeros minus poles? Let me check here. Oh, poles minus zeros. So minus zeros plus poles. Okay. So the sum of poles is minus 3 minus 2 plus 0 minus minus 1 over 2. So that's minus 2. Okay. Then I have phi A, which is 180 degrees over 2 and 180 plus 360 over 2. So that's 90 degrees and 270 degrees. Okay, so the asymptotes are going to be at minus, so the asymptotes are going to be centered at minus 2, and it will have plus 90 degrees and plus 270 degrees as the angle, so this would be my asymptote. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. Now, where is the root locus going to intersect with the imaginary axis? So let's look at this graph. So this pole, as you increase the value of gain k, this pole is going to move towards this zero. Whereas these two poles are going to move closer to each other, and then it's going to break away from the real axis. These are the asymptotes. So it doesn't seem like the root locus is going to intersect with the imaginary axis at all. Okay, so I can ignore number 4 because it's not, the root locus is not going to intersect with the imaginary axis. Let's listen to the reasoning once again. This pole is going to move towards this zero, so it's not going to intersect with the imaginary axis. These two poles are going to come close to each other as k increases. And then at certain value of k, it's going to break away from this real axis and move into the imaginary part of the plane. Not imaginary part, but real plus imaginary part of the plane. And then these are the asymptotes, so they are going to converge to the asymptote as k goes to infinity. So they are not going to intersect with the real the imaginary axis at all. And therefore, we don't need to worry about number 4. Okay, so it's not going to intersect with the imaginary axis, so we don't have to find anything about that. Next in line is to find the breakaway point. So of course, there is going to be a breakaway here. At somewhere between minus 2 and minus 3, the root locus is going to break away from the real axis. So we need to find the breakaway point. Since none of the root locus is, so none of the roots or poles or zeros are in the complex plane, we don't have to worry about the angle of departure and angle of arrival. So the only thing that is left away is the breakaway point. So let's calculate that. Okay, so I get an expression like this. I only have to worry about the numerator. The denominator I can ignore. What are the roots of the numerator? Well, now I cannot compute it by hand because it's a third order polynomial and I need to find the roots of a third order polynomial. So I'll plug it in my calculator or my computer to find the following roots: minus 2.46, minus 0.77, plus minus 0.79j. Okay. This number is not on the real line. I have to ignore it. This is on the real line. Let's check if it is between, if it is on the root locus. So here is minus 2, here is minus 3. So minus 2.46 is somewhere here. And that's where the root locus is going to break away from the real line. And now I have to draw a curve that starts at this point and then converges to this asymptote as k goes to infinity. So let me just draw. A curve like that. That's the root locus for this particular GS. Okay? Any question? Yes.
So now that we know this, how does that like help us as we're designing a control system?
Yes, so we'll get to it in a bit. Okay? We'll get to it in a bit. Perhaps not in today's class, the next class, but okay. So now that we know how to draw root locus by hand, let's look at this specific example. Assume that we do not know what root locus is. We are given this transfer function, and we are asked the following question. Consider a feedback, simple gain feedback controller. With a negative feedback, this is my R of S, this is my Y of S. And I'm asked the following question: is this system going to be unstable for any positive value of K? Okay? What do I know about the open loop system? Well, the open loop system is marginally stable because you have a pole at the origin. So the open loop system is marginally stable. I used a simple feedback controller, simple gain feedback controller, and I'm asked whether the closed loop system is going to be stable or not for some value of k which is positive. How would you answer a question like that? What would be your strategy to show that for all values of gain k, the system is going to be stable?
Maybe find the transfer function in whose array.
So if you find the transfer function, it's going to have third order polynomial in the denominator, and you may not be able to solve it for all values of k. Right? So if you have a third order polynomial with, let's say, this 6 replaced by k, this 10 replaced by 8 plus k, how will you solve for the roots of this particular polynomial for all values of k? That will be a problem, okay? I don't know what that number was. 6? Okay. So we can't use that approach. What is the other approach you can use? You can construct a root array, and you can show that for all values of positive k, The first column does not have any sign change, so that would imply that it's always going to be stable. But all you can answer is the stability part. If you can draw the root locus, which as we have seen for this particular transfer function, it's almost immediate, right? You go through the seven steps and draw the root locus. Of course, once you draw 5 or 10 or 15 root locus, you will become so good at drawing root locus that you won't have to go through many of these calculations. You can just draw it by hand without any problem. So anyways, so you can go through those seven steps, you can draw the root locus, and not only you know that the system is going to be stable for all values of k, you also know exactly how the poles are going to move as you increase the value of k going from 0 to infinity. So k equals to 0, this pole is going to be here, this pole is going to be here, the closed loop poles are going to be here. As you increase the value of gain k, the closed loop poles will move in the direction of this 0. These two closed loop poles will come closer together. You increase the value of gain k even more. You will have closed loop poles at this location, and you will have a double pole at this location, at the breakaway point. Increase the value of gain k even further. You will have closed loop poles here, and you will have closed loop poles here. Increase the value of gain k even further. What should I use? I'll use dagger. So you'll have your closed loop pole here. You will have a closed loop pole here, and you will have a closed loop pole here. So you can actually identify how the closed loop poles are going to move as you increase the value of gain k, right? And you will know you have one pole at the real axis, and you have two poles with some imaginary part. Until this value of gain k, there will be no overshoot whatsoever because you don't have any oscillations in your system. But after this value of gain k, because you will have certain poles in with non-trivial imaginary part, you will have oscillations in the system, okay? So you can come up with all these insights without necessarily having to do a lot of work, okay? Just by drawing the root locus, you can get all these insights immediately without much problem. That's the value of being able to draw root locus. And now you can imagine why it was a valuable tool back in 1948 when it was first, this entire construction or the seven-step process was devised by Evans for general system, where the poles and zeros are kind of known for that particular system. Any question? Yes?
Could you describe again what's going on between 0 and the unit in this
k? So between in this region?
Yeah.
So as you increase the value of gain k, so gain k close to 0, you will have a pole here, and you will have two poles here. You increase the value of gain k even further, you will have one pole here, and you will have two poles, a double pole exactly at the breakaway point. Then you increase the value of gain k even further. The pole is going to move in this direction, but this pole will actually move into the imaginary plane. Okay? So you will have two poles, one pole here and one pole here. Increase the value of gain k even further, you will have one pole here, and one pole here. So let's put some values of k so that you, so this is k equals to 10, k equals to 15, k equals to 25, k equals to 100. Okay? So as you increase the value of gain k, you see exactly how the poles are going to, the closed loop poles are going to move in the complex plane. Okay? Now let's get to the question. No? Let's get to the problem of control system design. And recall our discussion about the dominant poles, which we barely touched upon in one of the previous classes. Closest to the imaginary axis. Okay, I'm assuming that the system is stable here. So all the poles are in the left half plane. And I'm looking at the pole that is closest to the imaginary axis. Okay. So let's say I have two poles here, one zero here. Two poles here, one zero here, and two poles here. So the dominant poles are these are my dominant poles. Okay, one of the things we discussed is if you give the system a step input, these poles are not going to dominate the settling time or rise time and things like that, because they almost immediately respond to the input. The most sluggish response will be because of these two poles, okay, and that's why they are the dominant poles. What would that imply? If you want certain constraints, if you have certain constraint on your settling time or percent overshoot or rise time and things like that, you need to make sure that these poles are as far away from, well, not as far away, but these poles are meeting those requirements. Because if these poles don't meet the requirement, there is no way your overall system will meet the requirement. Okay, so at the very least, you want to make sure that whatever constraints you may have on your settling time or on your percent overshoot, these poles should be able to meet those requirements. Okay. Now, when you have these two poles, it gives rise to a second order system. Okay. So, if you just worry about these two poles and ignore all other poles in the system, they act as a second order system. And for second order system, remember, G of S was omega n square over S square plus 2 zeta omega n S plus omega n square. We had these two poles. The real part of the pole was minus zeta omega n. The imaginary part of the pole was omega d, which is omega n square root 1 minus zeta square. The absolute value of this hypotenuse is omega n, and your zeta is equal to cos of theta, where theta is this angle. Okay, all of you remember this discussion from the second order systems? Okay, so this is my root locus for a third order system. We had just drawn it a few moments back. what would the dominant poles be? So for certain values of k, I'll have poles in at these locations. And so the dominant poles are going to be these two poles, right? This pole is far away from the imaginary axis, so I don't have to worry about it. Okay, if I have certain specification on my zeta, so let's say zeta is, let's say I'm given a specification where zeta is greater than or equal to 0.5. This would imply that your theta should be greater than, oh, less than or equal to cos inverse 0.5, okay? So I draw these two cones with angle making angle of theta, or not theta, but let me call this theta bar. And in order to meet the specification, in order to meet this specification, which requires my zeta to be greater than 0.5, I need to make sure that I pick a value of gain k such that my closed loop poles fall within this region. So how do I draw the region? My closed loop poles must be within this cone. So I cannot pick a value of gain k such that my closed loop poles is here. Okay? I have to make sure that I have to reduce the value of gain k so that my closed loop poles are within this conical region. So that's one strategy for using root locus to meet certain specifications. So in this case, the specification is on the damping coefficient. You may have specifications on the settling time. And if you remember, the settling time is dependent on zeta omega n. Okay, so that will give you certain specification on. So if you have a settling time requirement, that will give you a specification on making sure that your gain is gain k is such that your closed loop poles lie to the left of this particular line segment. Okay? So of course, right now it all feels very abstract, but in the next class, I'm going to use the root locus method to design a controller, and we are going to use this idea of dominant poles, these topics we have studied for the second order system. So we use this as a proxy for designing the gain k for the closed loop system for a more general system. So we'll make sure that all these specifications are met for the dominant poles. And then we'll do trial and error to make sure that the specifications are met by the closed loop system for the overall system, because the overall system will not only have dominant poles, but it will have other poles as well. So we need to make sure that all the requirements are met. So we'll study that in the next class, and wish you a wonderful break. Hey.